Next as you've heard this meeting request this morning, we pray your blessings upon each one. Father, you've heard the names mentioned out loud. You know the desires of our hearts, and we lift them all up to you. We pray that you intervene in every situation. We give you the glory and the praise and all of it. We ask your continued blessings upon this service, upon everything that is said, done, sung, and played. And we'll give you the glory and the praise for all of it. We pray your blessings in Jesus' name.
Alright, before I go any further, and I think I know the answer, but is anybody visiting for the very first time? I hate not to ask, but I know there's it looks like everybody's face I have seen before. So, alright, if not, let's all stand. And we're going to do the first and last verses of Joys of the World. Then the next two songs just be the first verse of each song. And then the last one, as we have heard on the Bible, will be the first and last of it. Okay? All stand.
Thank you.
Irene is back. She's had surgery, she's doing well. And so I know that if you get an opportunity, go to the back and catch her before she leaves. Say hello to her. I know she appreciates knowing that you will for some time. Also, those who listened in through Facebook Live, we had some of our folks out of town this week. They're not with us in body, but they're with us in spirit. And then we have many other family and friends that are listening in. And we appreciate those as well. There's been several key words that we remember throughout the Christmas season. And joy is one of them, and love, of course. And then there's that word peace. And you know, the inspiration for a message comes in many different ways. And actually, Tao had posted something on his Facebook page that really stood out to me. And kept looking at it, and the Lord just kept working. So we're going to look at this word called peace a little bit more. Let's turn to Matthew chapter 5, verse 9. Matthew chapter 5, verse 9. And I'll tell you what Tao would put in just a few minutes. Matthew 5, verse 9. I hope everyone had a wonderful Christmas, a holiday with your families and friends. And I know some are traveling, some are here. Ms. Barbara, and she'll be going back in just a few more days. So we appreciate you being with us. And then Joanne's back with us. She was traveling through the holidays. God bless you. Matthew 5:9 says this: Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, we do ask your blessings upon the reading of your holy and precious word, upon the message of this hour. May we glorify you and honor you in all that takes place here today. May every word spoken honor you. May every scripture that we read bless us. And may we in turn bless you in the invitation. We love you and we thank you, Lord. And we pray that you give us what we need today. In Jesus' name we do pray. Amen. It is said of Jesus in Isaiah 9:6 that he is the Prince of Peace. It is also said in Psalm 4, verse 8, I will both lay me down in peace and sleep, for thou, Lord, only makest me dwell in safety. It is said in Romans chapter 8, verse 6, that we are to be spiritually minded, and that it will bring life in peace. And then it is also said in Psalm 29, verse 11, that we are told that peace is a gift of God. Listen to how it says it. The Lord will give strength to his people. The Lord will bless his people with peace. And then in Psalm 34, verse 14, we are told to seek peace and to pursue it. And so peace is mentioned throughout all the Bible. If you look through a concordance, you would see tens and tens and tens of times that the word peace is mentioned, not only in the New Testament, but in the Old Testament as well. Now, our text for today is probably an unusual one for the Christmas season, but listen to what it says once again. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall see God. They shall be called the children of God. As I mentioned a while ago, what I saw on Tao's Facebook page was a quote that sort of inspired this. Listen to what the quote said. Peace on earth will come to stay when we live Christmas every day. Now, think about that. Peace on earth will come to stay when we live Christmas every day. I like that. And more than just like it, I believe that's true as well. That's a true statement. If we were to live Christmas every day, then there would be more peace on this earth. I have seen a lot of people make quotes wishing everybody Merry Christmas and being more joyous and giving out gifts and trying to reach out to people that was less fortunate and just trying to make Christmas better for other people. And if we live like that every day, don't you know there would be more peace on this earth? We live in a world that is filled with chaos, strife, fighting, conflict, and rivalry. If you were to look at the history of the world, there has been more conflict than there has been peace. Throughout this world, nation against nation, even civil war within the nations, and even families and churches, we all struggle with this thing called peace. And the thing is, there's not going to be no peace unless we turn to Jesus. The Bible teaches us this. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. Every level of society is filled with conflict, with trouble and strife. Not only the political realm, we'll see that, and we have seen it in the past, we're going to see it in our present day, and as Jan alluded to, we're going to see it in the future. And it's just gotten so bad that you have to be very particular who you vote for today, because there are extremes of what they believe in, and it's no longer you can vote for the best person. It's got to the point you have to vote for your party, because every person is straight down the line of their party. And some are going, even the Democrats within themselves are fighting amongst themselves. Republicans are fighting among themselves. And so we see our political spectrum is really in a world of chaos. We need some peace. And then let's go beyond that. In our state, not only the nation, but even in our state, there's a lot of chaos and trouble going on. Go beyond that. In our families, families are broken. There's strife, and there's a lot of conflict. And then even within the churches, there are some churches that are celebrating Christmas and they're saying hello, brother, and hello, sister, and they talk about one another like nothing's business. And so we need peace. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. In the midst of such continual strife, God calls on his people to be peacemakers. You and I are to be peacemakers. Now, there are two types of people concerning peace. There's peacemakers and there's peace breakers. And so we see this going on in every spectrum of society. Let's talk about the peacebreakers to begin with. Peacebreakers are those people who break down relationships. They cause trouble. They cause division. They cause strife. They're confrontational. And they have to confront you and disagree with everything, or they won't be happy. That's how they get their joy, just being confrontational with everyone else. Their motivation is not for you. Their motivation is for themselves and for their own self-gratification. For such people, the Bible has strong words. Listen to what it says in Romans chapter 16, verse 17 and 18. Now I beseech you, brethren, mark them which cause divisions and offenses contrary to the doctrine which ye have learned, and avoid them. For they that are such serve not our Lord Jesus Christ, but their own belly, and by good words and fair speeches deceive the hearts of the simple. And so the Bible is very strongly giving us advice how to deal with these people. We cannot afford to have peacebreakers in our churches or even in our homes. For confrontational people will cut the very heart and life out of the church and out of a family, out of a local assembly, out of a home unit. And so they hinder the movement of God, and they will destroy the revival, and they will destroy the family unity. The most obvious way a person becomes a peace breaker is by the use of their tongues. The words they say. Not only the use of their tongues and what they say, but how they say it, the tone of their voices. And these people, they're a force against the church of God. They're a force against a family home. And they try to tear down and cause division and friction. Listen to what James says about the use of the tongue. We're very familiar with it. But in light of the world needing peace, we need to be reminded of the use of the tongue. Behold, we put bits in the horses' mouths that they may obey us, and we turn about their whole body. Behold also the ships, which though they be so great and are driven of fierce winds, yet are they turned about with a very small helm, whithersoever the governor listed. Even so the tongue is a little member and boasts of great things. Behold how great a matter a little fire kindleth. And the tongue is a fire, a world of iniquity. So is the tongue among our members that it defileth the whole body and set on fire the course of nature, and it is set on fire of hell. For every kind of beast and the birds and the serpents and the things in the sea is tamed and have been tamed of mankind, but the tongue can no man tame. It is an unruly evil, full of deadly poison. Therewith bless we God, even the Father, and therewith curse we men, which are made after the similitude of God. Out of the same mouth proceed blessing and cursing. Brethren, these things ought not so to be. Doth a fountain send forth at the same place sweet water and bitter? Can the fig tree, my brethren, bear olive berries, either of thine figs? So can no fountain both yield salt water and fresh. Who is the wise man and endued with knowledge among you? Let him show out of a good conversation his works with meekness of wisdom. But if you have bitter envy and strife in your hearts, glory not, and lie not against the truth. This wisdom descended not from above, but is earthly, sensual, devilish. For where envy and strife is, there is confusion in every evil work. But the wisdom that is from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, and easy to be entreated, full of mercy and good fruits, without partiality, without hypocrisy. And the fruit of righteousness is sown in peace of them that make peace. Gossip, slander, being a busybody, going around being judgmental, all of these are destructive forces against the church and against the family home. They tear down, cause division, and friction. And whenever God begins to do something good, whenever the family unit seems to be coming together, there's always someone that wants to break it up. Always someone that can't stand other people being happy and getting along. Churches and homes can be shattered into a thousand pieces because of people who will not control their tongues. And they lash out. There is never a good reason for sins of the tongue. Physical abuse, it happens. Verbal abuse, it happens. Most of the time, people can heal from physical abuse. But very seldom do people get through the verbal abuse. Things that were said, even as little children, stick with them for years and years and years down the road. I watched a movie just a few days ago. I believe the title was Remember the Night. I'm not sure. It was Barbara Stanwyck and Fred and her. He was a DA assistant. She was a thief. She got caught. He felt sorry for her. Instead of going to jail, he paid her bond to get her out of jail and took her home with the family. Stopped by her home and stopped by his home. And the difference between the two homes was night and day. When she walked up to her mother just said bad things. And I knew you wouldn't amount to nothing. Just kept on. Even as an adult, the mother still had these words. Went to his home, it was a totally different scene. The love and the support. You know, real people face these things today as well. Things that were said or done to them years ago still linger in their minds and in their hearts. There is physical abuse, and then there is verbal abuse. And there are no excuses for sins of the tongue. Oh, how we need to be careful. That's the peace breakers. Those who try to break up unity. Those who cause division. But now let's talk about the peacemakers. Because that's what our scripture deals with. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. Peacemakers are a very different kind of people. They are different than peacebreakers because they set a guard on their tongues at all times. They don't have to lash back out because they've been offended. They learned in order to keep peace, it may mean to stay silent for a period. They think before they speak. And they are not confrontational just for the sake of being confrontational. You ever heard people say that they think it's good to have some confrontation? I have. Even a preacher and a deacon I've heard, they said, I think it's good to have some trouble stirred up in church. And I'm thinking, what? Jesus calls for peace. And I search for peace. I seek peace. I pursue peace. These peacemakers, They don't have to give their opinion all the time just because somebody disagrees with what they believe. They are able to walk away quietly. They are able to walk away and avoid a conflict when the situation calls for it. Peacemakers are prepared to put others' well-being above their own well-being. Peacemakers are motivated out of love for one another, real love. And if there is any motivation behind what you are doing or saying other than love, then you are not acting as a peacemaker. Let me give you an illustration. Wedding day was approaching fast for a young lady. Everything was ready. Nothing could dampen the bride's spirits and excitement. Not even her parents' nasty divorce. Her mother, Sheila, finally found the perfect dress to wear for the wedding day. And it would be one that she would be known as the best dressed mother ever of a bride. A week later, Jennifer, who was the bride's name, was horrified to learn that her new stepmother, young, beautiful Barbie, had the exact same dress that her mother had purchased for the wedding. She went to Barbie and said, "Look here, Barbie. My mom's got that same dress she's already had. Well, would you please return it and get another one?" And Barbie said, "Oh, no. I'm going to look fabulous in this dress. I'm wearing it." And she refused to give in. She said she was going to wear a dress. She went back to her mother, who graciously said, "Never mind, Barbie. I'll get another dress. It's not about us. It's about you on that day. And I want you to have a special day." 2 weeks later, another dress was finally found for her mother. And when they stopped for lunch, Jennifer asked her mother, "What are you going to do with the first dress? Are you going to turn it in?" She said, "Oh, no. I got a place I can wear it." She said, "Where are you going to wear it to?" She said, "I'm going to wear it to the rehearsal dinner." The night before the wedding. Peacemakers. That's what we need to be. Peacemakers will often, though, be crucified. Think about this. The greatest example of a peacemaker the world has ever seen was a man called Jesus Christ, who came to this world to offer peace between us and God. He came to be able to reconcile us to our Heavenly Father. You see, our peace with God was broken because of a man called Adam, who brought sin into the world. And because of that, we had no peace with God. But Jesus came that we might have everlasting peace through him to our Heavenly Father. Jesus' primary role when he came to this earth was to be a peacemaker. He was making real peace between God and you and I. Truth had to be upheld. And the truth is, for we have all sinned and come short of the glory of God. The truth is, in Isaiah 59, verse 1 and 2, it says, "Behold, the Lord's hand is not shortened that it cannot save, neither is ear heavy that it cannot hear. But your iniquities have separated between you and your God, and your sins have hid his face from you that he will not hear." So truth had to be upheld. We are sinners in need of a Savior. We were alienated from our Heavenly Father through Adam, the first man who sinned. And through Adam and Eve, every child is born with a sin nature. And not only was truth to be upheld, justice had to be met. Someone had to pay the price. For the Bible says the wages of sin is death. And instead of all of us dying and going to hell, Jesus provided a way of reconciliation. Jesus provided a way of peace. And he volunteered and said, "Father, I'll go in their place." And he died our death so that you and I could have peace with God. Real peace. A peace that brings restoration. Where we can be whole with our Heavenly Father once again. We all face conflict. Every one of us have faced conflict in family, on the job site, in the church. We've seen conflict take its place. In our nation, we see conflict. So all of us are very familiar with conflict that goes on. The most violent conflict that ever took place, though, was some 2,000 years ago when Jesus Christ hung suspended between heaven's glory and earth's gloom on an old wooden cross and died for our sins so that you and I could have peace that God gives. And the cross has continued down through the ages to be the ground of conflict. To deceive for those who are against God, they hurl every insult they can towards the cross of Calvary. It is a source of contention. Some have embraced the cross and committed their lives to Jesus Christ, while others have cursed the cross and ridiculed it. But it is absolutely necessary for us to have peace that God gives. And I must tell you that if you desire to be a peacemaker, if you desire to follow in the steps of Jesus as the Word of God calls us to do, there will always be those who will misunderstand us and our intentions. And there will be those they say that we are misrepresented. We don't honor God in our lives. We're not perfect people, are we? But we strive for that. We're to read and study God's Word and apply it to our hearts and become more like God. But we're not there yet. And so people throw at us, well, I'm just as good as they are. But no, you're not. We're all in a bad shape. We're all sinners in need of a Savior. But we can have peace through God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. You know, the newspapers have been around back during the days of Jesus. I can see the flaming headlines. Jesus came. He had been promised for hundreds of years, and now he has come. And then I can see the byline up underneath that headline, Jesus came. Jesus came to offer peace with God. You see, only when we accept Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior can we have peace with God. As I said before, we were all born with a sin nature through Adam. But once we turn to Jesus, accept his accomplished work on Mount Calvary and what he did for us, once we acknowledge our sins and ask God to forgive us, he adopts us into his family. And we become sons and daughters of God. And then we have peace with God. But not only that, we have peace of God. That is different than peace with God. To have peace with God means we've been born again and we reconcile to him. To have the peace of God means that even though the world that we live in is not perfect, even though we have heartache and heartbreak, we can have peace in the midst of our troubles. You see, peace is not the absence of troubles, but rather the presence of God in our lives. And he gives us that peace. And so we not only have peace of God and peace with God, but then we also have peace with others. I realize, and you realize, that some people are hard to get along with, aren't they? You say, hey, I see your hand. There's some others that are hard to get along with. But listen, as a child of God, we're to do our best, aren't we? We're to strive to get along with him. Now, Jesus, he didn't get along with everybody. Think about it. He strived to, but the Pharisees and the Sadducees used to make two groups of people. They were vehemently against Jesus. They offer salvation to whosoever will. And so, if you and I are going to be a child of God, as his word calls us to be, then we need to live in peace with others. As much as life in us, is what the Bible says. Pursue peace and live with others in peace, as much as life in us. Why will those who are called peacemakers be called the children of God? Because if you're really working hard to be his peacemaker, you're going to resemble God. You're going to be like your heavenly Father. And people are going to say of you, aren't they just like their heavenly Father? Aren't they just like Jesus? And so you'll be known as the children of God when you are a true peacemaker. I'm reminded of a story I told of a cold winter's day. A 10-year-old boy was standing barefoot in front of a store. It was a clothing store. Peering through the window, shivering with cold. A lady approached the boy and asked him, what are you doing? He stood there barefoot. And he was looking at the shoes inside the store. And he said this comment, "I'm asking God to give me a pair of shoes." The lady took the boy by the hand, led him inside, asked the owner of the store to please get her a half a dozen pairs of socks, and asked if there was somewhere she could go wash his feet. She took him in the back, got a basin full of water, washed his feet, dried him with a towel, come back out, put a pair of socks on him, balled up the rest of the socks, put it in his pocket, said, "They'll pick you out a pair of shoes, whatever shoes you want." He picked out a pair of his size and put them on, and boy, he was smiling from ear to ear. She paid for them, walked him outside, and said, "About, you feel more comfortable now. You go in peace, and you know somebody that always loves you." As she turned to go, she was astonished that the little boy grabbed her by the hand, looking up with tears in his eyes. He made this question to her, "Lady, are you God's wife?" She thought about that for just a moment. She said, "No, I'm just one of his children." To which he replied, "I knew you must be some kin to him." Now, isn't that the way we're supposed to be? That we can be so much like God that people can recognize, "I know you must be some kin to God." I believe it is. I believe it is. Peace on earth will come to stay when we live Christmas every day. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. I pray that each and every one of us will be more like God every day. That we are striving to become more like him. Let's read his word. Let's make a commitment to read and study his word. But more than that, to apply that word. So when people see us, we resemble God so much, they would say, "I know you must be some kin to him." And we are. We're his children. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for this day that you've given us. Pray that you would bless us and fill this, Lord, with what we need today. Father, we thank you for your Son, Jesus, who came to the cross of Calvary to die for our sin. We thank you, Lord, for the obedience of Joseph and Mary to raise him. We thank you, Lord, for each and every one who comes by way of salvation through the cross. Father, we ask that you would bless us now as we bow our heads and this invitation is extended. If there is anyone here, listening in through Facebook Live, if they need a special touch of Jesus today, you would reach your hand, comfort their hearts. Let them know that you care about them. If anyone needs salvation, Lord, that you would save their soul.